Now that I finally made the switch to a Windows platform, I thought I'd talk about the mid-2011 iMac that I've used since 2012. So you can look at this as a end-of-life review or very, very long-term review. So let's get into it. But before I get into that, if you're new to the channel, please consider subscribing. And if you do eventually end up liking the video, please hit the thumbs up button. So I bought this iMac back in 2012 for $1,800. I actually remember those three installments, three very, very painful installments. But at the time, it was actually worth it. The price was obviously high because of import duties. But what I was getting at the time was a 2.5 gigahertz quad-core Intel Core i5 processor, a 500 gig hard drive, 4 gigs of RAM, which I later upgraded to a max of 16 gigs of RAM, a beautiful TFT LCD HD display, AMD Radeon HD 6750M graphics, and overall beautiful design and more. Now, although these specs don't sound like much now, at the time they're actually cutting edge. In typical Apple fashion, the 2011 iMac is durable. I'm talking about Steve Jobs' Apple. Not sure if I can say the same about Tim Cook's Apple. I think the fact that we're still talking about the 2011 iMac points to its durability. My 2011 iMac has a few cosmetic scratches here and there, but overall, it has held up quite well. Even in terms of design, the 2011 iMac still looks decent. I think up to the M1 and M2 iMacs, Apple's design language remained the same for the iMac since, I think, 2009. So, in terms of look, the iMac still looks modern. Well, the only thing that gives the 2011 iMacs away are the huge bezels and the thickness, as well as the existence of a disk drive. Now, I don't think we actually appreciate how good these old iMacs are until you switch over to a new system. For example, the 2011 iMac came with an SD card slot, which makes it easy for content creators to move files between cameras and the computer. On Windows, you have to buy an external SD card adapter. The iMac also comes with very good inbuilt stereo speakers. On Windows, that is a separate buy as well. But to the Windows ecosystem's credit, it's actually very easy to upgrade components on a desktop as opposed to Apple, which has a lot of limitations. For example, with the 2011 iMac, you can only upgrade RAM up to 16 gigs, and Apple is still employing the same tactics to date. Now, there's no technology that is perfect. I've had a few components die on me over the years. The first to die on me was the disk drive. If you find a 2011 iMac that has a working disk drive, it's very rare. The drive itself would hardly play anything as well. So I ended up removing it entirely from the iMac to make way for an SSD and to improve airflow. I ended up replacing the hard disk drive with an SSD in 2019 when the hard drive just decided to die. If you're planning to get an iMac with a hard drive, switch to an SSD as soon as possible. There are a lot of videos on how to do it here on YouTube. The keyboard stopped working over the years and it did not make any economic sense for me to replace it. The mouse, it still works, but I don't want to go broke from just constantly buying batteries. The next thing to give out was the temperature sensor, which made the iMac fans run at 100%. Luckily, I ended up using software for that. I actually made a video about it. I'll leave a card above just in case you're planning on buying an older iMac. Even on the software side of things, life has been unkind to the older iMacs. I think the last official OS update was High Sierra 10.13 for this iMac. So a lot of third-party softwares are no longer supported on the 2011 iMacs. Even Google Chrome is no longer supported. Luckily, there are workarounds through open source softwares such as OpenCore Legacy Patcher. You might still run the latest macOS, but performance would definitely take a knock. Well, as for my iMac, I think it has reached that stage as well where even the OpenCore Legacy Patcher is no longer working on it. Now, the only reason why I decided to switch to Windows was that this computer could no longer handle my 4K video editing workflow. The 512 MB VRAM can no longer cut it. You might try to upgrade the GPU on the older iMacs by using old Alienware laptop GPUs, but in some cases you will lose the ability to adjust screen brightness. And personally, I'm tired. Now, the mid-2011 iMac can still be bought on platforms like eBay from between $150 to $250. Now, if you don't mind tinkering with your computer now and then, I think this is actually a pretty good deal. Looking at the quality of the display alone, and the stereo speakers, and the Core i5 processor, I think it's worth the money. The 2011 iMac has managed to hold its value. If you look at some PCs built around the same time, most of them are in landfills. Now, in terms of still being able to use the iMac 2011, if you can get over the hurdles of the operating system, I'm sure you can still be able to do some light 1080p video editing, maybe some audio production, some office work, and some browsing. Beyond that, I don't think it will be able to handle it. That's my long-term review of the mid-2011 21.5-inch iMac. If you found this video helpful, please consider subscribing and leave a like. It will actually help out the channel. Otherwise, I'll see you in the next video.